Good evening, CFAY. Our good friends out in town, Yokosuka, Nikishi, main base. I am Captain Dave Glenister. With me, as always, is Master Chief Marty King, the CFAY Master Chief. And we are here to talk about a few ICE comments, ICE being those computer terminals that you see around base and strategic locations to gather your feedback in a more formalized mechanism than some others that we sometimes get. I'll start by saying Happy Veterans Day. This will be airing a couple days after Veterans Day. Hopefully, it did something meaningful. Took some time to reflect. If you haven't, maybe you want to zone out during the rest of this broadcast and reflect while I'm speaking or something. But veterans are all veterans. That's the person who just signed up, just arrived here at CFAY, all the way to the person who did 30 years of service and has now been 30 years retired. Sure. And we, there's more to serving than giving the ultimate sacrifice. Every one of us who is doing our part for our country is honored on Veterans Day. And so we've had a few ceremonies on base, but congratulations to all of you for the hard work that you do every day in serving your country. A couple of safety notes here. The days are getting shorter in terms of darkness, but we don't change our clocks here in Japan. And so the drive to work may be done either in the evening or in the morning, maybe starting to go in darkness. It's starting to get rain on a rather less predictable schedule as we head towards winter, get towards a rainy season coming up here in the January time frame. So some of those long nights, some long weekends we have in long weekend season does make for potential for more accidents. There you go.
Yes, sir. And it might not be you that's causing the accident. It might be the next person. So let's make sure we always got that awareness 365.
Very true. And I usually don't talk about the scorecard of how many DUIs we've had or how many incidents of public intoxication. I know the vast majority of you, if you were sitting in the car next to somebody who shouldn't be driving, you would take the keys. I know that. So I'm not going to go out there and tell you to lead harder or something like that. But to Master Chief's point, you might be driving along perfectly fine, minding your own business, driving no more than 8 hours in a day and all those things, and the person next to you has been drinking or doing whatever. So it doesn't take two people that are either intoxicated or driving too tired or something to have an accident. It only takes one. So please be careful out there. Being completely responsible does not mean you're not going to get into an accident because it's not all about you. It's everyone else on the road. So please be safe out there. A couple of things. I do read all the ICE comments. I don't answer them all personally. That's what our people are for. They do a good job answering those. So as we go through, sometimes there are some comments about people did a great job and they've been responded to. Some things, some poor service. By all means, with the poor service piece of it, please be specific. As opposed to the, hey, some people down there have a bad attitude, right? Sometimes it's a one-off day. Some people do have a bad attitude. But unless you give us a specific incident and give us the information where we can contact you, not a whole lot we can do because it kind of becomes a he said, she said type of scenario. So we want to make sure we know that. Facebook, I don't really go on Facebook. I don't have a Facebook account that I share with everybody, certainly because I would have 22,000 friends rather quickly that I feel a need to be friendly with my friends and not just have Facebook friends. But sometimes you get some really good information out there. As my wife is fond of saying, at AOBICR, there are plenty of people on this base willing to help you when you go out there and say, hey, how do I do this? Or I'm looking for a place to go for my kids. Does anyone know of a good kind of thing? And you get lots of responses. But just remember, these are very good but often unqualified information. So sometimes, we don't say the blind leading the blind, but there is a lot of mythology. Well, sometimes we say that.
Yes, sir. We do say that.
Yeah, we do say that. We just don't say it on the air like we are right now, which I guess we just did. No, but sometimes there's information may have been accurate. It may have been correct when you arrived here 3 years ago, and sometimes now it is not. But there are some things you really got to be careful about that are important. Going with your Facebook info, and there's a couple here that I just want to call out. Traveling throughout Asia, great opportunity here. ITT does a fantastic job. Even around Japan, you can get trips where they will take care of everything for you and everything else. You can go off to the Great Wall of China, go see Shanghai, go see Beijing. All that stuff's taken care of. But the issue came up with passport. And so as I heard of this comment, because how I usually get this kind of feedback is, hey, sir, is it true that X as we're doing a captain's call or talking with some of the folks who work in our command building, or I'm going around and seeing the clients, as I like to think of all of you. And so one of them is, hey, can you travel on a no-fee passport? Well, you can travel on a no-fee passport as long as it's official government travel.
Official travel.
Yeah. And in the back of that passport, it says the bearer of this passport is on official government travel. And no, to my knowledge, you cannot travel for tourist purposes on a no-fee passport.
No, they need a tourist passport. It's very simple and easy to do. They can go right online, fill out the application, mail it in. They can even, an extra fee, have it expedited on an overnight mailer back to them. But can't travel for a vacation to Vietnam on a no-fee passport if it's a vacation.
Yeah, and Roger, that perhaps it may have happened, that you know someone anecdotally that did go and use a no-fee passport and no one said anything or something. But the fact is that, the passport is the permission from our government to travel, and then a visa is from the country you're going to get in. And they will take a look at this thing, and depending on the country you are, there is a whole continuum of pain that you will go through once you arrive. I actually knew a guy who showed up in Singapore. Oh, we were in Singapore on the ship, and he had his wife come in without the proper visa, clearance, passport, whatever it was, and she spent 12 hours at the airport before they put her on a plane right back to San Diego. So that was a rather stressful moment. So anytime you're going to travel, do anything, do your homework, make sure you're good to go with that. But anyway, so I want to kind of clear that one, because I could see from the discussion I was having with this young sailor that there was disaster looming in her travel plans. So I just want to clear that up. The other one is a question that came up of continued logistics support. Now, what this is, it means if your military member, husband, wife, whomever, is leaving the area on orders, permanent change of station orders, there is opportunity to request continued logistics support, which means you are allowed to stay even though they are not here. Now, there's a little more to it than this. I will say that we very often, because they all come through Fleet Activities Yokosuka,
yes, sir,
for endorsement to U.S. Forces Japan, and they are very often wrong, and the paperwork's not filled out. And I understand that, because very often you will do this once in a lifetime. So why would you know any better? And so we try and work with the commands to get this correct. But I wanted to kind of put out to folks, because there's a lot of information and misinformation going out about there. So if you are, suppose your wife is getting a permanent change of station, and she is going from, I don't know, suppose she's going from CFAY to one of the ships here, say USS Steedham or something like that, has a long pipeline back in the States. So she's going to go for 2 or 3 months on all this training and then come back. You can apply for continued logistics support, which means you're allowed to stay in Japan. So use the school, military family housing, all those kind of protective rights that you normally would have, even though under SOFA, Status of Forces Agreement, they're not here anymore for those few months.
Yes, sir.
And then they come back. Now, there's another situation, which is the military member is leaving and not coming back. So suppose your wife, member of CFAY, now has orders to USS Umpty Scratch out of Norfolk, and is going to go through their pipeline and then go to Norfolk, not come back to Japan. And you have the intention of, say, leaving your kids in school for the school year or one of these types of things. You can also ask for continued logistics support. However, and there's one more paragraph that's added, and it's pretty short, but it is pretty meaningful. And it says things like, you do not have SOFA status. You cannot have a car. You cannot use the commissary or the exchange or any of these other things. And so a lot of times, I don't think folks quite understand that. You may have the option of leaving your family here, but boy, unless you were going to do a lot of walking,
yes,
around, it is really not a great experience for your family to be here with no SOFA protection, no car, and having to shop off base, which is what has to happen. So I guess, the long and short of it is always do your homework.
Yes, sir.
In this case, thanks.
There are other situations, too, that we talked about earlier. Four cases where it wouldn't necessarily meet the criteria of continued logistics support. But, for example, if a service member here in Yokosuka was married to a Japanese national, and the Japanese national stays, Then they would go into continued station allowances, vice logistics support, just to draw the OHA, overseas housing allowance, for their dependents location here in Japan when they are completing their tour. But there is a lot of, we see these on a regular basis on continued logistics support, and they just don't meet the written criteria to be approved.
Yeah, it is a pretty high bar. And of course, you know, we don't try to be bad guys and irritate people just because we can. But the reality is that very often most commands are pumps and not filters. Yes. of these types of requests. So they'll come up and they'll get endorsed and everything else. But we do feel an obligation to let you know what you're getting yourselves into as you do these things. And so when we push back, that's usually the reason why. So by all means, not asking is the same as no. And you could certainly, anything in life, do what makes you happy, knowing the consequences of what you're doing. So, yeah, we'll continue to staff those. But it's a pretty high bar. USFJ, U.S. Forces Japan, is not really thrilled about some of those. But we know if someone's going to stay here for a short period of time, a couple months, finish out the school year, graduate with their class, of course, that's easy. Staying here for 6 months to finish out a semester, probably not so much. Even though I've known people who've actually left their dependent high schooler with another family to do that.
Yes.
And that of course, happens. But so some of those, you got to look at all your options there. Well, anyway, enough said of that, I think. Let's get to some ICE comments.
Oh, the best part.
All right. So since it is mandatory that families move to Ikego, which it isn't necessarily, but we'll talk to that, the demand of shopping carts in towers has increased. There are not enough shopping carts at Kyoto Tower to accommodate residents. Well, two things. One is it's not mandatory to move to Ikego, but it is mandatory that we fill up our housing.
Yes, sir.
And so since Ikego has been has the most houses available, yes, Ikego, I think point taken, Ikego is starting to fill up. And so those services, we've actually started looking at some other things too. The potential, not sure if we can, but things like the CDC hours for pickup and drop off, the parking for the CDC.
Yes.
Pickup and drop off, things like the next auto port. Clearly, if you're like me living in Ikego, I was late by the time I was pouring my coffee in my cup before I left my house in Nikko Tower. So I didn't have time to stop for gas in the way. I always gassed up the night before, and having the auto port kind of close the same time as here doesn't really count for the transit time that most of the residents would take to get back there. Same with the CDC. So we're looking at some of those. Not even sure if we can. We have some hours requirements. But worth looking at.
Yes, sir. And I know the Nex is doing the same with their hours for the auto port there. And CDC, it may, our MWR director, which CDC falls under, is looking into how many providers we actually have and how many hours are they authorized to work in a day.
That's right.
Not necessarily about pay, but because it involves childcare.
There is kind of, there are certain legal requirements that we have to meet with that as well. And we do have, child care is on our brain, especially at Ikego, as we start filling up. We know that things are going to change out there, and gym hours and everything else. But to this question, the follow-up says, Ikego Housing Office will provide additional shopping carts at the Ikego high-rises. That's all well and good. But I will share with you that there are some, occasionally. When I had a four-year-old, he used to say, are they bad people? I said, not bad people. They're maybe just not being as good citizens as they can be. They will take their shopping cart. What happens is at Ikego and towers here in general, you drive into the front. There's these shopping carts. You load your stuff in there, bring the elevator with your groceries, and then bring the shopping cart back down, or not, as the case may be. So quick C story, which I know the Joe, our production guy here, is saying there's no such thing when Captain Glenister's talking. But I was, of course, at sea, which I was two-thirds of the time, my last time in Ikego. And so she's got the brand-new baby, and she's got the five-year-old. And there's, of course, no shopping carts. Why? It was easier to bring it up than bring it back, because there's a place to stack these shopping carts. So she tells my older boy, Aiden, who's five, and says, Aiden, go up and find a shopping cart, because there's the cameras on the elevator that show the outside. And she says, just go here and get that shopping cart and come back. He goes, okay, mommy. And so he goes in, but she's got the baby and the groceries in the car. And he goes up to like the third floor and gets a shopping cart and brings in the elevator. And then the elevator keeps going up and up. And he gets another one and another one Because he's like, I remember when the elevator opened the way down all these carts. So he ends up with all these carts and bringing them back. So luckily, there are cameras. You can see all these things. So yes, my five-year-old was out there collecting these shopping carts. So by all means, two things. One, when you're done with your shopping cart, please bring it back. Please don't haul your stuff from the mini mart off to its tower. And but if you have to, I know that sometimes that you feel you have to for whatever reason and your circumstances trump all the rules. But by all means, be a good citizen. Please bring those back. Bring because back. There is some woman with a baby and a five-year-old who's trying to get her groceries up there and can't because there's no shopping cart.
Yes, sir.
And so it's not just the number of shopping carts. It's also returning when you're done. And I was the same way. I used to see those all the time. There's always a shopping cart outside someone's door. And you know, go knock and see if they're done with it. When we know they're done with it, we're just trying to be polite about it. So anyway, but I think we're going to take care of that one. Okay. This one goes out to the MWR Akego Fitness Center. TVs have not been working for 2 weeks. Comment cards not provided. Comments about the treadmill has been broken. It's a broken screen. And the elliptical machines have lots of rust. And there's cobwebs with spiders. Actually, I was up at 13 Halsey, which the PCO of Antietam is now selected as his house. And I went back there. And for you Lord of the Rings fans, it was like Mirkwood Forest back there. I mean, it was like Halloween. You didn't need any Halloween stuff. There's monster spiders back there. So you got to stay on top of this thing. So I...
They're all over.
In the words of Bill Clinton, I feel your pain. But this one has been successfully answered, I believe, for this particular incident because it talks about, yes, they fixed some of the screens. Some of these things are going to be done. But the one I want to address is the rust on the machines. You know, some of these places that we have, both not necessarily a Kago, but there is some other Hawk's Nest gym and some other stuff with, you know, of opportunity equipment and some things like that. You know how it gets humid in there. You know how hot it is, and some folks like it that way because that's you know enhances your workout type of thing. And sometimes there is surface rust, but we do make sure first and foremost the equipment is safe to operate. And once that's done, some of the cosmetic stuff we just let slide because with the manpower and the dollars that we have to let it go, if the structural support on that thing is not. Not bad. We just don't go after the rust as much.
The availability of the equipment.
It is. In some cases, a little WD-40 and a rag goes a long way. Yes. It's just surface rust. But rest assured, the equipment is safe. So I understand that, and we go after that as we can. But don't be afraid of the of some of the rust that is you know not impacting the equipment. The equipment's going to get old. It gets used a lot. Hopefully it gets used a lot. We pay a lot for it.
Yes, sir.
And it's a service, and we do a lot of that stuff. So I hope it gets used. So the key is to make sure you report the unsafe conditions. We make sure it's in good working order. But the other stuff, I think, has actually been addressed.
Yes, folks. The cable and all of that was already fixed.
Yeah, the cable, television.
2 days after they submitted their
comments. Yeah, that's good. But that's why you submit it. Yeah, you submit ICE comments so we know these things. Okay. All right, here's one. I'll throw this one over to Matt Chief. But who was responsible for cleaning the wrestling and MMA mats and bags at Fleet Rec Gym and Hawk's Nest? Hawk's Nest in particular, I haven't seen any spray bottles to spray down the mats.
That's an easy one, sir.
Mm.
We all are.
Yes.
If you use the equipment, there is you should be cleaning them up. MWR does provide wipes. If they are out of wipes, please find one of the fitness staff over there, and they will replace them for you. Our MWR folks actually come in, and they wipe everything down and do a deep clean on each of those facilities every day. We, as the users of that equipment, have a responsibility to take care of it, clean it, and make sure it's ready for the next person to use.
Yes, and related to Hawk's Nest, it particularly does not have great ventilation, not designed as a gym.
Yes, sir. We do not have an HVAC system, heating, ventilation, air conditioning system in our Hawk's Nest. However, we are looking at, one, how do we fund it? And two...
Magic. So far, it's been magic.
Sometimes having a space available
is
pretty much the key in itself. We actually shut down the Hawk's Nest during the summer due to the excessive temperatures there. However, it's open up back now, and it's an available space that can accommodate large groups of people.
Yeah. So this related to the particular comments, and I think these were successfully answered, I believe. The cleaning of Hawk's Nest is a group effort, but ultimately falls on us. This is being answered by the MWR staff, and we acknowledge that. You know, it's our job for sanitation and pieces like that. But we do ask that everybody kind of helps out. The mats are kind of a different, you know, A lot of folks use the mats and don't wipe the mats necessarily. And I understand that as well. But they are taking more towels over there. They are doing more disinfectant spray for the facility. And they, you know, thanks again for your comments. And so again, you've identified a problem. We're making some changes. Like we said, it is good PRT weather. I think CFAY, we got our PRT. We're doing throughout November. Perfect time of year.
The last day.
As long as it doesn't rain, it's good. So anyway, out there, be safe when you're out there. I was unsuccessful in my younger years of adding the blocking sled portion of the PRT. I thought it was very unfair that all you cross-country runners were smoking me out there. Well, you know, we used to do the Marine Corps PFT when I was a midshipman, which was a three-mile run, and pull-ups and sit-ups. And, you know, we had a lot. I mean, I was a lacrosse player, so you think I'd have done better on this thing. But we, you know, we run continuously but slow as defensemen. But, yeah, so but it is good PRT weather out there now. And so the hawk's nest is open as well. It's nice chill in the air. However, it can also cause a great deal of humidity by doing that as well because you have the cold air coming in. And then things, although it's cool air, it does cause it to rain on the mats, to speak, a little bit too. So you got to strike that balance as well. So that may be some of this as well. So anyway, enjoy the weather while you can. Yeah, I've shifted to the outside now that it's cool enough. Yeah. And hopefully we'll do it as long as we can here. I wanted to recognize Tammy Bickle, CDH. My daughter's been there for 2 months. I am incredibly impressed with Tammy's professionalism, knowledge, organization, and dedication. Normally, I don't call out people by a specific name. I did want to do this for several reasons. I do thank you for hiring such incredible providers. And it's a two-way plug here. One is that folks who run our CDHs, all very dedicated people, they go through training. We certify them. They all have to be approved before we do that. And so thank you for those that step up and want to take that on. But the part of that is it does take time to create another child development home, which is what we're talking about. So you have your child development centers. These are child development homes where people are authorized to take folks in. And there's certain numbers based on age and things like that and certification. We would like to create a lot more and to take over some of this daycare load that we have. And as we put more folks out of the CAGO, as you have identified, there will be more requirement out there as well. So it's not just enough of the right number of child development homes, but where they're located, convenience, hours, those types of things. So if you are inclined to become a child development home or are interested in either using them or becoming one of the folks who is one of the administrators or providers of one of these places, then by all means, we have FFSC has some resources there. Yes. The N9 organization, we call it MWR, but it's really more to it than that. They do child youth programs. They run the CDHs, the FFSC, all that falls under them. There is a process. You can find out about that, and by all means, sign up to be a part of this thing and look into that. And we're happy to have you. Actually, what happened was Operation Tomodachi, when a lot of folks left and there was a big gap in people here, a lot of those CDHs that we had, we didn't quite seamlessly get them all going again.
Yes, sir.
Because even if the homes were ready to go, the clients weren't there, and so a few things like that. And so we really have not, we've really been working to build up our inventory of child development homes. So anyway, with that note of both a plug to our people and our request for you folks to step up if you're so inclined, we'll take a break here and give you some informational statements, and we'll be back in just a minute.
And now let's take it to our DJ correspondent at Yokosuka Way, MC2 Brooks, with another CFAY scoop, talking a little bit about the Festival of Trees. What's going on, man?
Yeah, well, you know, the holiday season is coming up, and everyone loves to decorate, you know, holiday trees, Christmas trees. So the base here is actually having, like I said, the Festival of Trees. Basically, at this point, they're open for registration. This is for any of the command, shore base, or ship base, and also any organizations around the base too, like, you know, USO, anything like that. So basically registration is open right now, closing about November 15th, but definitely try to get in there, and this way you get a chance to actually decorate a tree.
Yeah, and you get your registration done early too, so you can participate in this event.
Exactly. I mean, you know, 9 times out of 10, you have your tree at home, you get to decorate it. Who gets to see it? You know, your family, maybe some friends. But with this event in particular, you know, everybody gets to check it out. They all get displayed on December 7th and 8th. And people get to come by, check out this tree, and doesn't have to be any traditional even decorations. You can, you know, kind of take your own theme depending on what your command or your organization wants to do. But basically, it's a way to have fun, show some holiday spirit, and be able to show that off and show off some pride.
Great. Well, where else can people find some more information about this?
Well, you can definitely contact the MWR Recreation Office here on the Yokosuka base in room 215. They also have a phone number. This is 243-1215. Basically, like I said, just go there, sign up, you know, get your commands information out there, your commands pride and spirit, and hopefully have a good happy holidays and get to show off some fun there.
There it is, folks. Get registered and get ready for the holiday season. Hey, thanks so much for the CFAY Scoop.
Anytime.
All right. Catch you later.
Bye.
Welcome back, Captain Dave Glenister, Master Chief Marty King. Back going over some ICE comments here at CFAY. Here about mid-November-ish. I believe you have just seen some information about the Festival of Trees, kind of a fun event that we have here at CFAY. They put them up there in the C2 building, the command building, and do all this command decorating of different things. Ships have different themes. We try and change ours up every year. I'll make ours a surprise as to what ours is going to be. But there are some deadlines you have to be aware of, which, you know, are coming fast upon us after the airing of this thing.
Yes, sir. The deadline for the commands and organizations that are going to request a tree through the lottery, because it's actually done by a lottery system, is Friday, November 15th. The lottery will be done at the end of that day. Please check the slide. Get with the point of contact if you haven't already done so. For our deployed commands, one, thanks for being out there doing what you do. But two, for the families that are back here, your family readiness groups and your ombudsman can put in for those trees for that command as well.
And we obviously, you know, we like to make a big deal of those ships that are gone and participate in any
great
of our events.
It's really nice up there in the auditorium with all the trees lit up too.
I've actually asked to leave the trees up a little bit longer this year just because we have some groups that want to come through and tour and see them and stuff like that. And it's no harm in doing that, provided, you know, our good fire chief, you know, agrees that it's no harm in doing that. So, but it is. It's a lot of folks go with a lot of effort. We have some kids come through. We have some other off-base groups come through. And it is a lot of fun. So please make the most of that. So be aware of all those informational statements. I do want to make one more plug here, like we did last time, to sign up for our informational email type statements, whether it be for a gate closure,
yes,
a big change of plans for whatever reason, or a typhoon rolling through. That is cfay-cdns@fe.navy.mil. And you provide that email address with your name, your phone number, your email address that you want these notifications to go to, and you will get them. Provide your phone number, and we will only use that if we need you to do something. So, for instance, we need you to shelter in place, or we need you to stay, or need you to come in if you live off base, or one of those types of things. And there's any number of scenarios that you can imagine why that would be. But this is how we get the information out there. And then, of course, friend us on Facebook there, the Fleet Activities Yokosuka page, because we do put a lot of information on there as
yes.
well for these types of things. Particularly for base closures and other stuff. Not base closures, but I would say gate closures or certain times. And, you know, there's maintenance sometimes on some of the pop-up gates and things like that that are just, you know, irritating and inconvenient. But it can certainly help you plan your day a little better if you know it's coming.
Yes.
And so sometimes if it happens on short notice, like, and it hasn't really happened here that I'm aware of, but some naval stations, sometimes they've had a maintenance problem where the thing pops up in place and they've got to close a gate for like the rest of the day. And having this kind of information pop into your phone or something means you go out Womble Gate instead of the main gate.
Yes, sir.
It just makes your life a lot easier, right? Because once you're stuck in that line to get off base, you're kind of
not turning around and going back.
You're part of a long caterpillar that's not going away. So, okay, let's get back to some comments here. I'd like to provide a compliment about the recent platforms installed in the pool. We are a family of small children who have used the pool a couple years now. Prior to the platforms being installed, it was very challenging to allow our children to practice swimming without a PFD.
So. Yes, sir. We put a false bottom in the shallow end of our pool because the shallow end of our pool really wasn't that shallow.
It's all in the eye of the beholder.
Yes, sir.
Not good for hobbits.
It was good for a 6-foot tall person who does triathlons, but probably not good for a 3-year-old trying to learn how to swim. It really hasn't affected it. You know, the pools are there for everyone. And we've actually received a lot of comments from folks that use the pool about they were very happy that we installed that false bottom.
Yeah. There's some that are not as thrilled. Some folks training for, you know, triathlons or other kind of, you know, serious aquatic endeavors.
Yes.
I would say. And we try to be accommodating as many folks as possible. But being we only have one pool out there, we try to, you know, we try to cater to our hobbit population as much as our children population. And this is really the way we try to do that. And I think it is good. But I felt like bringing that out there and acknowledging that I know some of you are a little less than satisfied because it may interrupt your flip turns and things like that. But we do have an obligation to go after as much of the population as we can and accommodate them. To that point, we are already starting to look at, you know, what we're going to try and do and the waivers we're going to try and ask for kind of pool operations next year. Because, you know, ask early, ask often. As I've learned from my aviator friends, the first person to the blackboard wins. So if we can actually put some good justification into the ability to open up some of these pools, perhaps we can have more than just one open, which is the guidance. But we're a big place.
You know, yes, sir.
22,000 people on this naval station any given day, if all the ships are in. So we want to make sure that we can accommodate as many people as possible. And we're going to try and do what we can. So anyway, so when that happens, you know, we'll I thought I'd bring it up here, kind of remind.
Yes, sir.
Note to self. Okay, this is about the next beauty shop. The color product fades very quickly. I'm disappointed in the salon. Does not do keratin straightening at all, and the humidity destroys a lot of women's hair. So this one is in the building at H20. And so the comments, as often happens, there's a note to the customer, but I want to use this opportunity to address some things to everybody. The beauty associates are attending Refresher Premier Customer Service Training and looking at the feasibility of carrying the products that this woman suggested. So your comments, being specific, both not only in, you know, there's some customer service concerns, but also in the products and the styles that are being given, are being addressed. We also do have a new beauty salon.
Yes, sir, we do.
Just about to open here soon. It's been a project that we've been talking about for a while.
Yes, sir.
Here, and our own folks at the Next doing a great job brokering what kind of businesses have an opportunity to be here and contracts and things like that. This is one of them.
Yes.
And so we're going to have some more opportunities, some more chances here, some more things here. So hopefully that'll alleviate some of the concerns that are out there. And with that, you know, things are going to change on base. They always do. We have an IHOP coming in, I think, January, February-ish.
Yes, sir.
There's always, you know, anytime you have this long-range contract, sometimes, you know, things change in the contract.
We are due an update on that one.
Yeah. So we'll have to see exactly where we stand on some of those. But that stuff always happens. But things change. Things go well. Okay.
I didn't have the problem with hair straightening or dyes. You might need some dyes, sir.
Vicariously.
That's good.
Vicariously. I live through my people. And sometimes, yes, I wish I could dye my hair a darker color or something. Maybe that spray stuff that adds hair automatically.
Silly string.
Yeah, something. That's right. Purely a vicarious experience for me, the hair salon. All right. So here's a I had no problem with my newly made ID, like I've had in the past, with programming my room key on it. New machines appear to work better than making IDs. Well, I'm not sure it's the new machines or that the new leadership. It's a leadership problem. I don't know. But
we did a software upgrade.
Is that what it
was? Over at PSD. That's why we actually had a shutdown. Well, it was twofold. We did a software upgrade, and then we had a shutdown because of another reason. But that also upgraded over at our FAST office at Fleet Family Center store. But yeah, so hopefully the software is running, because there are times under the old software when it could take half hour to 45 minutes to make one ID card, and it wouldn't work in a CAC reader.
It's two words for that: unsad.
Yes, sir.
All right. So, well, it sounds like we got
a great job to those guys over there.
A little bit of feedback, and I appreciate the job that PSD was doing to kind of minimize the impact there. And the FAST office, as you know, also kind of takes up a little bit of the load.
Yes,
there. It's a luxury we have. Well, anyway, thanks for your comments. It's good feedback. Pass that on to those folks at PSD. Great job. Thank you to the CFAY Housing Office for giving the newly arrived sailors the opportunity to choose their housing unit. As you know, that is kind of a new thing. Some folks are surprised it always hasn't been that way. There's a lot of reasons why it's hard. It's harder on our folks. There's a lot of, you know, anytime there's more flexibility, it can tend to be a bit just jumbled, but that's why we did it as giving it a shot here. And looking forward for the same option to be given to those that currently living off base. So, and we are looking at that. There's different phases of this thing. Our mandate to move folks back on, and how and when we do that, we're looking at specifically whether we go to a waiting list, those who've lived off base the longest, to give them the opportunity, perhaps to do it at a new tour. So for instance, you've done your tour and you're going to another ship or you're going to another PCS somewhere else here in Yokosuka, and we'll say, hey, we'll treat that like your new arrival or something like that. I'll tell you what we're not going to do, and I regret that if you are personally inconvenienced, we're not going to go to those folks who have been assigned in the last 5 months who were not given as much opportunity as others, and give them a do-over and pay a government move to do that. We discussed that, and we came up with this pilot program that we're going to have a cutoff date. We're just not going to do it. And I acknowledge there's a lot of folks in that category who are rather unhappy with their housing selection. And I regret that there's nothing we can do about it at the moment. But we are going to move forward on that. We've also decided that we are not going to force people who to move on base, that we had to put on a waiting list out in town. Most folks in that category are waiting for 2-bedroom units, of which there are just not a lot of. And so what had been happening was we were forcing people to, well, not forcing them, but they were moving out in town because there was no place for them on base. And then when a unit became available, we were saying, congratulations, we're moving you on. And so two things were happening that I was not thrilled about. One was some folks were waiting to get their stuff as they were, you know, hoping that their housing unit would pop. And they're living kind of out of a, you know, the crash kit and stuff like that. Yes. And rental furniture and milk crates like I did all the way through college. And waiting for their stuff to arrive. Or people who are happy where they were, like their neighbors, like their neighborhood, are now said, congratulations, glad you're settled. We're ripping you out of that and bringing you on. So what we've done is, for those folks, kind of like in that stage two of the pilot program, but one of the changes we're making is we will give you the opportunity when you're come up on that waiting list and a unit's available, we'll ask you if you want to accept this unit. If you say no, you can keep your OHA, keep your place out in town, and you just come off the waiting list. There you go. Because I know a lot of you are happy out there. And so why would we move? So it's a win-win. You get to stay where you're happy. I don't have to pay to move you on. And we're good there. Because if these really are such high demand, someone else is going to take that unit very soon. So that's the other thing, too. So we do have some other things in the works here for that housing stuff. Okay, the next one is calls out a date and a time and a license plate. Someone driving recklessly on a Kago. The unsafe driving culminated with the driver of said vehicle passing our car over the train tracks, not stopping while the train bells were chiming, the bars were coming down. Well, of course, that's illegal in Japan.
Yes.
And it's stupid everywhere. Not to put too fine a point on it there. But the only and so appreciate this comment. The only thing I'm going to add to it, which is unfortunately, it says no follow-up information recorded, which means without having you to have a sworn statement, and I'm not saying like, you know, swearing, but to actually file a complaint that we can use, there's really not a whole lot to go on. And while I have no indication that you'd be fabricating the story, we need someone to be the witness of this thing in case you have someone who really has it in for someone who stole their shopping cart or didn't bring it down from the tower and now they follow them out of there or something. So please, I have no problem with this type of information. I have no problem with this ICE comment. I pick up my phone and I call people all the time on this whole ticketing and illegal parking and stuff like that. And oddly enough, when I say, hey, there's someone illegally parked here, something happens. But you should have that same right. But we just need your information on here. So next time, and never be afraid, we're not going to call you out or hunt you down for anything you say in here. By all means, put your contact information and we will follow up because, this cheeses me off too. I don't like that.
No, that's a bad situation that they described in there.
And every time they get away with it, they think they're going to keep getting away with it. So that's no good.
But please leave your contact info where we don't pass your contact info out to anybody or everybody. You will be contacted directly by the responsible person, and in this case, it would probably be our security officer at CFAY to ask you for any other information that he needed. But if you don't leave your contact info, we have no follow-up, and we're not really able to take action.
Yeah. So, and very often the ICE comments are responded to by the department head. So some pretty heavy hitters are taking personal interest in things you have to say. Okay, here's another shout out to the USO and NWR and Benny Decker for the Far East Movement concert.
Yes, sir.
Glad that went well.
Very successful.
I will throw on the fire department folks as well, who a lot of times these things come up. They got to jump through a lot of hoops.
Crowd control and capacity and
protection. There's modifications being made to that theater that's rated for a certain number of people and a certain number of stuff. And I'll tell you what, you may not see them as much, but those guys stress out on these situations, which is great because, I mean, they care about this kind of stuff. And in this particular case, because there was some concerns, I mean, smoke machines and some other stuff, I mean, they just said, we're going to move next door to that thing and brought a unit over.
Yes, sir.
Because we wanted this thing to go off well. So hats off to those folks as well.
Good time to put a plug in for the USO, too.
Oh, yeah.
USO sets up a lot of great entertainment events that comes to the installation and all other installations and commands around the world.
Absolutely.
And if you really want to make a difference, volunteer at the USO. They'll need your help on Thanksgiving, Christmas, and any other day of the year. And it's a great organization. They have a new facility. But those guys are making this stuff happen for us in addition to MWR.
They are. And, of course, now they're located next to Fleet Rec, where they used to be kind of semi on-base, off-base. It's kind of a out-of-the-way location. So now they're in a great location if you haven't checked that out. And they do. I mean, worldwide, they do so many good things for everybody. So they are doing a great job. And so, yeah, by all means, if you're inclined. And, you know, your kids will see that you give your time to others, and they will become that same type of person. It's a good way to go through life. Okay, here's an issue I'm just going to go through real quick. This was someone went to PSD, and they did not have all the paperwork to get a new ID. Young sailor went there with their chief, and it did not have, I guess, the XO signed it, but didn't have the XO title in the block. So I think, is this passport or what is this one?
It was a ID card replacement.
ID card replacement, okay. And so the comments were, hey, anyone knows a green pen's the XO. Well, actually, that's not true. Well, yes, it may be the XO. However, only blue or black ink is actually authorized. So I'm not going to go down that path of saying it must be the XO because it was in green ink. Those comments aside, yeah, I'm sure PSD and the PSD officer, great guy, is probably going to look at this one. Yes, I know there's sometimes people following the letter of the law. It's very DMV-like when you get this number of people. I say DMV with ultimate respect. And the number of the volume of things you have to handle, it is very tough to go case by case and try and, well, can't you tell it's this thing? Personally, what ended up happening was the PSD folks said, this paperwork is incorrect. Please bring it back when it's filled out correctly. Now, were I that chief, I probably would have said the only thing that's missing off of this thing is the title of the officer that signed it. There's no problem in filling in the title. Okay, you obviously can't sign for somebody unless you have bi-direction authority. But for the rest of the paperwork, I probably would have just wrote in XO and then moved on with my life smartly. So I'm sure the mass chief is probably thinking the same thing.
I'm thinking a lot of things, sir, but that's one of them.
Seeing as a chief is a senior to the E5, a mass chief is a senior to a chief, as a chief is to an E5, that kind of mentorship. But yes, I can understand how this would be a rather frustrating and irritating moment in life. So perhaps that kind of interaction would say, hey, the paper is not filled out, but you can take this clipboard and finish filling it out right here, rather than either implying that you had to take it back to the ship to do it, would have been a better way to go from the PSD side. I don't know all the ins and outs. But yes, no, you're not going to go falsify some signature. But if it's just a question of who the person is on the paperwork, I don't know why you just wouldn't fill that in. So I regret that you had a less than stellar experience over there. By and large, they do a lot of great work. And I know that everyone who goes over there is usually in a time crunch situation. And your time is valuable. And I regret that it seems like your time was wasted. Here's one regarding taxis, which, by the way, I have recently authorized taxis to pick up and drop off on Halsey for those few of us who live over on Halsey. You know, we don't like taxis to go up and over and be a thoroughfare because we do have a lot of kids and it's dark and it's a hill and stuff like that, but neither here nor there for this purpose. The comment is, I spent over 45 minutes trying to get a taxi this morning and the base taxi service did not answer the phone. Understanding it's raining today, it shouldn't be this difficult to get transportation at 0645 to 0745. Right. True. I mean, this is obviously the day you want to get a taxi when it's raining.
Right.
And so a very good comment. I want to pass everyone else. Please accept my apology for what you experienced that morning. Did some research, found that time, especially on a rainy day, is one of the taxi's busiest times. So they spoke with a taxi manager, discussed adding additional dispatcher and having more taxis on the road. And effective for November, that's exactly what he's going to do. So again, your comments related to this.
Effective change.
Effective change. We'll move quickly. I'm getting a 5-minute sign here. Want to take a minute and let you know an outstanding job the youth sports personnel, the Marines, and volunteers did during the Nerf Zombie Madness. Fast Platoon did a great job on that. I think we commented on that before. And you went down there with your guns, you got your Nerf stuff, and took out a bunch of zombies. And I was down there. My kids went through a couple times. Everyone between 7 and all the way up was doing a great job there. Some kids were scared. It is Halloween. Scariness is okay. But yeah, fantastic job. Good job. Let's see here. There was one here about kids attending a Halloween carnival at the Purdy Gym on a Saturday afternoon. And there's the guy who hires the DJ, was a DJ for the A Club in Sharky's Bar. He forgot who his audience was and was playing age inappropriate music.
Yes.
I got to tell you, I've had it with this stuff. So we're not going to do that anymore. I mean, DJs, we're just going to get out of the DJ business because, you know, especially with the kids' events. This is the second time I've heard one of these things. I'm tired of this thing. So I see no reason. I mean, a DJ has a place. He plays to the crowd. It's an audience type thing. It's interactive. It's particularly at a club and things like that. When your job is to hit play and let it run, I don't even know why we're paying for that guy. So why, you know, someone can't just crack that code themselves. So yeah, when it comes to kids events, you know, we're gonna take a hard look at this one. And I don't think we're doing DJs anymore unless we can, you know, the guy's wearing a clown suit because, you know, I am tired of this. I'm tired of this thing. So yeah, you're right. Thank you for the comment. I appreciate that. Please start issuing parking tickets to owners of cars who utilize Naval Hospital parking lot near buildings E-22 and 3213 who do not have a hospital decal. Unauthorized personnel use this parking since it's close to Womble Gate, sometimes unable to park there. Well, I think parking on base in general, I am this close to deputizing, you know, all my E-7 and above, and certainly my off-duty CFAY security with a ticket pad, because this stuff happens all the time. And the fact that our security force, when they're in their role, is actively employed and usually in a car going around, you know, I think it would not be unreasonable as a trained security force member that you can just, you know, call it in there or issue the ticket as you're going out on your way, provided you're within your reasonable faculties and things like that, on base, doing your normal stuff, because that's really where a lot of this stuff happens. People over at you know, the commissary and the exchange and pulling spots that they're not supposed to be pulling into, particularly the Gold Star
family spot.
That one I have, you know, my tolerance is way down on that one. That is reserved for people who have lost a loved one in combat, and people pulling there, and I'm not going to put up with that. So, because that's just disrespectful and all the other things. So I see a reason why we shouldn't be able to do this. Just get some more people throwing out tickets.
Yeah,
you know. I bet if I charge a $1,000 fine, I have a lot less parking tickets, but I can't. So, you know, it is what it is. But yes, you're right. I find it irritating as well. Today I called for storm damage in my house. They told me they would send someone to repair the damage, but would not tell me what time or what day they would be there. They work all week, and it's a real waste of time for them to keep going to my house after I tell them no one's going to be there. You know, with storm damage, I think we racked up on the order of barring some port ops things. Every storm, I'd say between $20,000 and $40,000 of damage. It's a lot of damage. And most of it is, I'd say most of it's in housing. The most individual units, probably because the housing units are small. So if we have damage to a building, it may be rather widespread, but we say building, whereas the housing units are rather smaller. Singular. So we single them out. We do have a lot of those things. So I request your patience with that kind of stuff. And it's generally not housing. It's NAVFAC that gets that request. And so they push that on there. And yeah, you see them after the storms. They go out there and start going after this right away. But I understand it's rather tough to get into some of those things. Service calls. It's like waiting for the cable guy, right? We'll try and do that.
And make sure they know who they're. A lot of times these service calls are actually going to NAVFAC. And NAVFAC receives so many of them after a storm.
Right.
But they really can't tell you when they're going to be at their house. At your building, residence, whatever the case is, and we'll work with NAVFAC, and housing usually does a very good job of notifying. They put notices up when they're going to be there for their maintenance.
Yeah, and they've got a lot to get to, so they're going to try and do that as best they can. Suggestion to ease the traffic at Womble Gate in the afternoon when everybody's trying to leave the base. Authorize use of the middle lane, certain times given. Make this lane for outgoing vehicle heading straight, and make left lane for traffic going whatever. I think the security officer put this one in because he just talked to me about this. There's no signature on this thing.
But you know, there's another.
This has got Lieutenant X written all over it. No, but actually, this is a serious point. This is a good idea, regardless of who you are who put it in here. What's supposed to happen is that left-hand turn lane is supposed to all go left.
Yes.
And we put our sign out there, but quite frankly, it is outside the gate. And so what's our authority to do that? The bottom line is that we want to keep traffic moving through Womble Gate, which is that side gate there. So the left-hand, I think we're going to go with this, which is if you're in that left lane, you are making a left out. And if you want to, you know, spins the wheel and takes your chances of when that light's going to change and you really got to go straight, then you'll be the right-hand lane. But that left-hand lane, you go down, you make two blocks, make a right, you're right back on 16, and you're good to go. So, yeah, so you might be, we'll put some word out about this, but you might be seeing a little bit of a traffic pattern change. Certainly some enforcement with some cones out there. We got to talk with the JPS, the Japanese, because we're actually in their turf. But they in the past have supported us on this and actually appreciate it. So anyway, good suggestion, because, yeah, we want to clear that out of there as much as possible. I would like to know why the band schedule can get so messed up.
You can do this to me all the time.
Okay. I know. It's in the CPO club.
Yeah, right? It is.
Okay. First, the Far East Texas band. Is it Far East Texas band? Far East Movement. Is this some other band I'm talking about? Anyway, was to play Halloween, and then they were not. Well, that would be the definition of change. Unknown to them that they were not. Now I am told they are playing tomorrow, unadvertised. Well, how'd you know if it's unadvertised?
Yeah.
This has really been an injustice to anyone who plays here. Well, you know.
The band that played Halloween at the Chiefs Club was advertised for a month straight, Captain. Sorry you didn't get to have your favorite band that night, but we did advertise.
We're laughing because we know the guy. It's all right.
However, I think they put Coors Light for this same individual comment maker into the area. I wouldn't put that in my refrigerator, sir. But
no, yes. This is our last frequent flyer of the Captain's Corner program. That's all right. I know it's irritating. And I think the point, the takeaway of this, now we've had some fun with it, is really, we'll do our best to try and make sure we advertise those schedules and stick to them. Hopefully they don't change. Sometimes things do happen when they do. And that's unfortunate that, you know, people's plans get changed and things like
that.
So, but we will try to make our best to have a plan, stick with it, advertise it. And if it does change, I'll try and put that word out. So roger that. I'm not trying to minimize the comment. Just having a little fun with it because that's what we're all about here.
And I believe Navy Entertainment that controls the entertainment for MWR activities over under our MWR director is already looking into this. And they do a very good job, but sometimes they actually get their contracts at the last minute and they don't have the time to advertise that far in advance when they are going to have a venue play at one of any of our clubs here on the installation. So
Yeah, we just got another minute here, I think. A few quick comments. One is the stairwell outside of PSD building close to the ATM machine needs to be lit up. Now the sun sets much earlier, it's darker earlier. And when I leave from work, the stairwell is completely black, making each step impossible. Two things. Yes, you're right. I believe it's an emergency exit. It needs to be lit. Now, to that point, I don't think you're supposed to be going up.
I don't think so either.
I don't know. I don't know. But we are going to, we should have a light there of some type.
Yep.
Because it is unsafe. Here is a, I understand the need to budget with the heat, air at certain times and dates, but the towers are so poorly insulated. They are indeed. I am pretty low maintenance on most things, and most things I just deal with. I can't get past the arbitrary dates for turning on the heat in the air. Well, I'm sorry you can't get past it, but you're going to have to because, unfortunately, the systems are integrated. You can't just do that. I'll tell you, I like winter better than summer because you can heat yourself up without heating the whole room up, clothes and stuff like that. Whereas the air conditioning, you got to wait for the whole room to get cool, and that's just rather unpleasant. But I understand that, you know, it requires a space heater, requires everything else. But we have to turn those off, and it takes a certain number of days to get the system ready for heat, and that's why we do it. So, I agree. I was bundled up when I lived here in a tower and the windows and everything else. But to that point, you know, go out and get some foam and some caulking and things like that. to get ready for winter.
Right at the
get ready for winter.
Housing self help shop too.
Oh,
as well.
Good. Yeah. Yeah, Next Depot has some of that stuff too. Last comment I placed an order on Friday night for Pizza Hut at 1709. I was told by the person taking the order that my pizza should arrive by 1800. My pizza did not arrive till 1841. The driver was apologetic and gave me 50% discount. I think that's fairly reasonable. I think it's pretty good. Not a reasonable amount of time. No, I appreciate the discount, but you know, yeah, you were irritated, and I would presume that they probably were overwhelmed and busy, and that's probably why it took so long. Which is also probably why they didn't call you to say get back to you and tell you it's long. You got on this escalator of pizza delivery, and oh, by the way, this is building A920, which is that little Pizza Hut shack. So you're probably on a ship about 100 yards away from this thing. So you have my permission to go walk down and get your pizza. But no, point taken. But I think it sounds like they tried to do the right thing. And I know you probably weren't totally satisfied with the answer. And especially when you're trying to order something for dinner and you have maybe follow-on plans. If you've got a quick pizza, then you'll meet some friends or something like that. And that's unfortunate that happened. But I think they tried to do the right thing. But it's certainly not out of malice. And I would suspect the reason they didn't call you is because they're just totally slammed. They get a lot of business down there, particularly when, you know, people are just tired of, you know, long days. The same ships where people working long days or working late, a lot of times, a lot of pizza orders. Same thing. So
it's the same boat.
So I think that's all we got for this time on Commander's Corner. Keep your ice comments coming. Appreciate it. If I apologize if we inadvertently offended somebody with the apparent cavalier attitude towards some of your comments. We just kind of have a little bit of fun with it. I assure you, we address all these very seriously. And even those things that are simple as, hey, the movie schedule or this stuff. Hey, you're the customer out there, and we're here to take care of you. And we'll keep doing that. So keep your comments coming, and we'll see you next time.